October 8th meeting with the State County Board of Chosen Freeholders. We begin, as always, with our conference agenda. And a roll call with
Freeholders Ochter, Bass,
here.
Duffy,
here.
James, LaFleur,
here.
Deputy Director Lazare,
here.
Director Bartlett,
here. With that, in perfect timing, arrives our County Administrator of Genova with the Administrator's Report.
Thank you, Director. Unfortunately, our honoree this evening had an emergency and couldn't be here. But I guess I'm going to turn it over to Frilla LaFleur, Frilla Lazara.
Yes.
Both our two resident Italian freeholders here to celebrate Italian Heritage Month.
So, Italian freeholder,
Frilla James. Bruce, you want to go up there and walk in? Many people don't know a little unknown fact about Frilla LaFleur is she was actually born in Duluth. Most people don't know.
In lieu of our guest of honor being here tonight, I guess come to say a few things about the Italian American population here in Passaic County, specifically Patterson. Do you want to start? Okay. Just a little bit of background, and I can actually go by my own family's background, where the Italians came to Passaic County about the 1880s, 1920s, in that time. They came to work at the mills, their homes, and their businesses, and their whole lives. You drive around and look at the mills, you see a lot of houses around. That's where they lived. That's where they worked. And you built this county up by the need, the Industrial Revolution, obviously. That had all these jobs open. And we've had waves of immigration, starting with the Irish, the Italians, Germans, Latinos, I mean, everybody who came to Passaic County. My grandfather came from Sicily, my grandmother came from Italy. And they settled here in Patterson down by Chauncey Street, which was always known as Little Italy. St. Michael's Church was there. My grandmother worked in a jute mill. For those of you that don't know what jute is, it's a burlap type material that was manufactured here, and hers was actually on Ellison Street. And it's built up. My uncle went on to become a doctor in Patterson 70 years ago. His daughter continues to carry on his practice here in Patterson. You know, when we talk about Italians, we talk about cousins. Well, our cousins can be our cousins' 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 cousins. However, they are still our cousins. So we have a deep sense of family, work ethic that probably is second to none. And we love this city, we love this county, and I will pass it over to you.
Thank you.
I don't think everyone wants to hear my last story.
Yeah. Okay, good evening, everyone. Every ethnic group that's come to this country over the years, over the decades, even over the centuries, has contributed to this great democratic experiment called the United States of America. Every group can talk about its contribution. Every group has given valuable contributions to make up this great nation. But we're here today to talk about the contributions of the Italians. As many of you know, when we think about Italians, the first thing that comes to mind, especially when we're talking about explorers, we talk about Columbus, who from very early age in school we learned about him. There was also Vespucci, Marco Polo. When it came to the sciences, we talk about historical figures like Galileo. Galileo actually created the foundations of modern mathematics. And many people know Galileo as the astronomer and all his work with that. Interestingly, he was the first one back in the 1500s who talked about the planets revolving around the sun. Was considered heresy at the time, and for his vision, he got locked up for life. So it was a different time back then. He was also the founder of what we call physics today. So Italians can take ownership of brilliant minds who've contributed in many aspects. When we talk about other artists, we all know about Michelangelo, Da Vinci. Michelangelo, as we all know, painted the Sistine Chapel. Da Vinci's famous for the famous portrait of Mona Lisa. When it comes to artists in the world of opera, we all know who Pavarotti is, Andrea Bocelli. The Italians are very famous for their opera and the composers that created them. Giuseppe Verdi, who created Rigoletto, Addia, La Traviata, Puccini, La Bohème, we all know that one, Tosca, Madame Butterfly, and Puccini's final opera was Turandot, which is the opera that Luciano Pavarotti made famous. Actresses, we have Sophia Loren, Marissa Tomei, we all know who she is, a wonderful actress. We have Sinatra, we have Rossellini, we have Coppola, we have Pacino. By the way, an interesting fact I found out about Pacino, his parents divorced when he was two. He lived in New York City. And he moved in with his mother's parents, who came from Corleone, Italy. So for all you Godfather fans, it's a little bit of a tidbit there. When it came to heroism, the most that could be said, or the first person that comes to mind when it comes to Italians fighting for this great country, during World War II, a Marine gunny sergeant named John Bassolo, who received the Congressional Medal of Honor for charging a machine gun nest and saving tens of lives at Guadalcanal. Unfortunately, Sergeant Bassolo was killed in the landing of Iwo Jima. By the way, there were 27 Italians who received the Congressional Medal of Honor in all the wars fought in this country. That's a significant number. One more thing I'd like to add is when it came to the sciences, everybody talks about Alexander Graham Bell inventing the telephone. Well, in fact, Antonio Meucci, 12 years prior to Graham inventing the phone, actually put together the first phone experiment where he communicated with his then ill wife. And it was a way of him keeping in touch with her while he was out doing his thing. But unfortunately, he didn't have the money to protect it with a patent. And along came Alexander Bell, who was famous for it and who got the notoriety for inventing the phone. As our administrator said, there was this young man who was born in Italy in 1952, came to this country in 1953, and he went on to be a councilman, a mayor, and your current freeholder. But the most proudest that I am about who I am today is I am grandfather to two wonderful children. So, by the way, I'm married for 46 years, same woman, and and don't tell her I said that. I'll please. But overall, Italians make up the largest European community in the state of New Jersey, and they're fourth largest in the nation. So we are significant in numbers. We're about 1.5 million here in New Jersey. We continue to contribute day in and day out. Italians are fiercely loyal to the country that they serve and to their families. And that's what they're really known, emphasize their cooking. But they're really fiercely loyal people. And I'm proud and very proud to be able to represent and talk about the Thai Americans and their contributions to this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
If I can, just take a moment to recognize the president of the Roma Club, Chris Fallone. We just went to a flag raising, a time flag raising in the Borough of Woodland Park. We had Carell and Carell there. And I just want to acknowledge Chris for his great job there. Made the time proud of it. Very much so.
I appreciate you and for all the time to come to you.
Made up your time for the day.
Why not?
No quarter time.
And just as another note, this past Tuesday, I guess, in the city of Passaic, Freeholder Laura, former Freeholder, now mayor of the great city of Passaic, had the first ever Italian flag raising in the city of Passaic. Well attended. It was a lot of fun. Great honorees. Honored from very great people. But kudos to our former colleague and good friend.
You're modest because you were one of the honorees.
I wasn't being modest at all. It was a nice ceremony, and it was nice to be recognized, although not necessary. All right, moving on. We are honored to have with us here today Orville Morales. Orville, welcome. Why don't you come forward? Orville has been working on education, awareness of the amount of sugar in the drinks that are for all of us and to drink. You know, one thing I will say, growing up in an Italian household, we never had soda. It was an option. I don't know whether that was exclusive to my family, but we could drink wine at whatever age. Our parents thought we were responsible, but soda was never an option. And my two children have never had a sip of soda to this day.
Good for you.
Crazy as that is, not because we forbid it, just they don't like it. But Orville is raising awareness. There is a resolution on today's agenda urging support of the program, which is why Orville is here to kind of talk to you about it and encourage you to support the resolution that is before you. So welcome again, Orville. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Administrator. And first off, Alfredo Director, thank you for your time, members of the board. I'm definitely grateful to be here. I am from Patterson. I'm also from Garfield, right across the bridge. I'm just really excited to be before you today. And I'm not going to spend too much time diving into why sugar is such an issue. We know that there's an obesity issue throughout our country, as well as issues around diabetes and heart disease. We also know that according to the St. Joseph's Community Health Needs Assessment, one of the biggest priorities are related to nutrition, heart disease, and diabetes. In the state of New Jersey, 1 in 10 adults are dealing with obesity. Many more are dealing with diabetes. Now, of course, some individuals have experiences around sugary drinks where, in the case of Mr. Administrator, that it wasn't provided to them at home. And that's an important factor in whether it's something that you consume. But rather than diving into why sugar is such an issue, I want to focus on sugary beverages, because that is the easiest way that we consume sugar in our cuisines. But a quick intro of why we're focused on this. Number one, NJ Sugar Freed is the public campaign throughout New Jersey that focuses on this campaign. The Public Good Projects, as well as the Nicholson Foundation, are working in conjunction to try to focus on a very specific aspect of this issue, to decrease the consumption of sugary drinks. That means decreasing the sales. To give you a little bit of background, in 2018, we were able to decrease sales by 7.9% in Passaic County by focusing on working with community organizations like the Patterson Alliance, like UMAC ECHO, NJCDC, and many other organizations, as well as doing this work around the state. We also observed a decrease of 4% of sodas and sugary drinks. We're focusing on the demand for beverages, which goes into, if it's not in your home, you're likely not going to get the taste for it. Last year's campaign was focused on Latina and African-American mothers, because the approach of this campaign is very similar to how corporations advertise to our communities. They are looking at their sales. They're looking where they need to boost the marketing so they can keep those margins up. We are using the same approach with a fraction of the budget. We are a nonprofit organization, so it's going to be a fraction of the budget. So last year, with those results, we were able to see a shift in people's understanding of what sugary drinks are. It's not just soda. It is fruit drinks. It is energy drinks. It is Powerade and Gatorade and sports drinks. These beverages, oftentimes, to give you a quick story, I remember going to one of the health fairs, and this young lady was very proud of the fact that she doesn't give her children soda, so she decided to give them Gatorade. Gatorade does not have that much less sugar than soda. And according to the American Heart Association, it's well above what's the recommended amount for children and for adults. She had tears in her eyes, which hurt me because it made me realize how important this message has to go out there. So we use social media posts. We use very attractive signs such as these and posters that we provide for free to all of our partners. For those that agree. Just gently reminding folks that drinking water is a better option. And sometimes, and I heard a question, it's hard to cut from a sugary drink. But it's important to remember that even putting fruit in your water can make it taste a little bit better. And so last year, with using a social media campaign, this year we're focusing on New Jersey employers. From hospitals like Hackensack Meridian, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation has joined the campaign, St. Peter's Health System, Salem Medical Center down in South Jersey, have all started looking at their vending machines. Yes, hospitals also have to consider that they're selling sugary drinks to their employees. We're also looking at municipalities. City of Trenton, City of Garfield, City of Vineland have all pledged to join the campaign. We also have Garfield Middle School just joined the campaign the other day. We're not focused in schools specifically, primarily because we look at it similar to corporations. Where can we make the greatest impact to drop the sales of soda within the quarter and within the year? But what's different here and what's different today is that this is the first governing body that is considering taking this pledge here in the state of New Jersey, and that is huge. Because usually it's coming from the top down. It's a CEO, it's the CEO of a hospital, it's the mayor's office. They're taking the pledge, and through the administrative approach, they're making changes. But this is a governing body. This is the elected representatives that are also considering this matter. And you know, I definitely want to say thank you to Freeholder Octor, who helped get this together for today. I also want to give a special thanks to the Director of Health and Human Services, Charlene Gungill, who was very supportive since the beginning of this campaign out in the community, boots on the ground. Her staff have been very helpful in making sure that we're getting our message out there. So with that said, I'm open to taking any questions, but we hope that you vote for this resolution, and we'll be here to support you every step of the way.
I think Orville's already a question in terms of the pledge of if you could just talk about what the pledge entails in terms of sugary drinks and the vending machines and all that.
Sure. So we certainly give people options. We don't believe in removing all of the supply of sugary drinks. So we give organizations three different options. Number one is the gold level, and that's pretty obvious, removing all of the sugary drinks. The second is the silver level, which focuses on just looking at our vending machines and having a couple more healthier options. And the first level, which is the most easiest to implement, is just promoting more water. And this is what this resolution is looking at.
Here.
Thank you. I always notice that you have no idea I've become that guy who's looking at what people are drinking. It's actually kind of weird. So what it includes is that we will give you posters. We will give you all of the files. You can put your own logo on it that you can print and put it in public places throughout the county. Where employees congregate, you can put these neat little tank cards. You could also put posters that are just gently reminding folks to drink more water. There's a key here. We understand marketing works. And even if someone goes to a diabetes prevention program or if they go to a nutrition workshop, once they leave the doors of that workshop, they're going to open their phone and they're going to see that Popeyes has a new chicken sandwich. And they're going to see Coca-Cola is reminding you to empower yourself and do what you want and drink more soda. We are trying to combat them in the same way. We've seen results last year. And we hope with your participation and passing this resolution, we will give you all of the materials. It won't cost more out of the taxpayer pocket, but it's sending the right message. We can be healthier if you create a culture of health in our communities.
Mr. Administrator, if I may, I just want to thank Orville, who I've been lucky enough to work with several years and have known as someone who's always been very involved in State County and our community in different efforts, and it was the perfect match when he was hired as the campaign manager for this campaign with the Public Goods Project, and I was very pleased to be able to bring it to the Health Committee, which unanimously passed our participation as a county in the program, and through the director's guidance that we have a year of looking at our health institutions and our health efforts in Passaic County. This fits in perfectly within this year, and I look forward, Mr. Administrator, that we would get these the posters and the placards ordered. We can put our logo and our information on it and get it throughout not just this building, but also the court's buildings and the cafeterias that we have. It's critical because in two fronts, I think in an urban community especially, diabetes is rampant in large part because the cheapest option is often the worst option for you. And the soda comes with the meal, right? If you go to McDonald's, the soda comes with the meal. The soda's cheaper, the bottle of water is harder to find, it's harder to get. The soda comes in a more attractive packaging. So that's what some of this campaign is attracting. So diabetes and other sugar-related illnesses in urban communities especially is critical. Secondly, from a financial standpoint, as a county which self-insures, it's to our benefit that our employees drink more water, avoid health-related costs. It's good for them. It's good for us. It's good for the bottom line. So, in every way possible, I'm vulnerable and the Public Goods Public Goods Project for what they have undertaken. And I'm glad that we as a county have signed on to this campaign.
Thank you for your work.
Do you have anything to do with, like, the diet soda? Do you have a position on that?
So we don't necessarily take a position. We generally don't bring it up. There's pros and cons to diet drinks. So diving into it and encouraging, it's like encouraging a specific product, which we don't do. We find that if we just focus on water and encouraging that message, it'll allow us to at least see that decrease in consumptions of sugary drinks in general. Questions.
Thanks for bringing this.
And that's K-20 on the agenda is the resolution before you this evening.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you
everyone.
And you're a little bit of your hand. Well, thank you. Spoke to Neela back there, our public information officer, about getting the promotional materials.
You got it, absolutely.
And also, please put this on our social media, of course.
Yeah. Great.
Thank you. We had talked about, including in this week's conference agenda, conversation following up on some of the public comments last meeting, weeds along the roadside. I noticed two things, one of which is that no one is here from West Rutherford's meeting, and the second is that our roads director is not with us this evening. Philip Duffy, any objection to punting that to our next meeting?
No, not at all. I think we have something.
Absolutely. Yeah, let's do that, Dr. Gungill, and hopefully our roads director, Kenny Simpson, as well, have that conversation next. Is that all right? Does that work with the staff that you brought with you?
Yes.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much. So we will table that until 2 weeks from now. I guess, anything further on the administrative?
That is it, Director. Thank you.
Very good. So I turn to my left, the County Council, and a review of our consent agenda, K1 through K63. First of all, Council, are there any late starters?
Yes. Through you, Mr. Director, we have four late starters. You know that I'd like to bring to your attention. First, K64. Resolution authorizing shared service agreement for public health services between the County of Passaic and the Township of West Milford. K65, resolution to purchase via state contracts and county cooperatives. K66, resolution temporarily suspending the Passaic County Park Ordinance, which prohibits the use or sale of alcoholic beverages for a wedding at Garrett Mountain on Sunday, October 13th. And lastly, K67, resolution authorizing increases in rates for the medical benefits program.
No, this is new. We've been talking about it for the last few months. We were just waiting for the West Milford. We were waiting for West Milford Council to adopt the shared service agreement, and then we would this is we had now West Milford, Woodland Park,
Hailsen,
Wanakew.
I think that's a great example of how working well with the county government can save money for that service.
And directly through you to one, the late starter for allowing alcohol in Garrett for a wedding. There is also a wedding at the mansion this coming Saturday. Could we just amend that resolution to include that as well? So we cover all bases.
That's fine with me. Okay. Just out of curiosity, what if anything does someone who's asking for that accommodation for a wedding have to do or provide to us?
They have to provide the proper insurance, obviously, which they do. Yeah, right. So both were kind of in flux, and we kind of got the information late.
So as long as we can
just include the dimension as well. And if I could again direct this for you, just talk about K67, the late starter, which is setting the health insurance rates for 2020. I just would, for the record, like to say that our traditional plan will be seeing a 7.8% increase. Our EPO direct access plan will see a 2.9% increase. Both the POS plan and the high deductible HSA plan will see no increases, and there'll be no increases to prescription drug plans or dental as well for 2020. Okay? You could.
This is, so that everybody understands, this is based on 2019's usage. And so it's a direct result of what it costs us to provide the medical care over the year. So these are accurate reflections based on what our usage was this year. So I know we're switching providers for our administrative end of this on January 1. So I don't want anybody thinking that because we're switching providers, that there's an increase across the board on Blue Cross anyway, if they were Blue Cross private pay person. This has to do with what our usage was for the year. And our actuaries look at that and determine what the cost of our plan would be. And so it's based on that.
So these numbers would be the same regardless of the action we took in our last meeting.
Correct.
Correct. Right.
And also these rates are based on the same benefits as last.
Benefits are not changing.
Benefits aren't changing. This is just what our...
Well, it's really all claims driven. And the reason that the traditional goes up is that is the highest costing plan, and you know we still have 85% of our employees are in that traditional plan. So you know we have put in, we've negotiated with the unions that no new employees can go to the traditional plan, but you know it's a process. So
why you're going to EPO, which is not, it's in network, it's all in network, but it's essentially the same company.
Right. But again, very small percentages are in. you know, people like their insurance and they feel comfortable there. And just as a follow-up to last meeting, although I wasn't here for most of the public comment, it really has been very calm. We set up healthcare questions at passaiccountynj.org right after our last meeting, sent out a frequently asked questions list. We have gotten a lot of emails. We've responded. Have we caught up completely? We were having some technical difficulties, but we caught up completely with answering each email, sometimes multiple times. But it really has been smooth. We've had it in the interim. Negotiations with some of the unions where it seemed very calm. I had a conversation with another union this afternoon, and you know, again, once people understood exactly what it was, they're starting to understand that nothing is going to change. So I just wanted to inform the board of that.
Thank you, and I think you can drive off. Council, any to go to the discussion? Any questions from the board on anything that you presented that we haven't talked about yet? That brings us to the end of the conference. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Move it.
Okay. Second.
Freeholders, Oster?
Yes.
Bass?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Lepore?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazara?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Okay, which brings us to the beginning of the regular meeting with the Passaic County Board of Chosen Freeholders for October 8th, 2019. Lou, will you start us off with the open public meeting roll call?
Ladies and gentlemen, the notice requirement of open public meetings law has been satisfied with respect to this meeting, specifying the time, date, and location, including the annual notice adopted in the reorganization meeting, filed with the county clerk, posted in the administration building, and mailed to two newspapers in accordance with the provisions of the law. Freeholders, Opter, Best,
present.
Duffy,
here.
James,
here.
Lepore,
here.
Deputy Director Lazara,
here.
Director Bartlett,
here. Please rise for the invocation, pledge of allegiance, and the Lord of the Lord.
O God, who provides for thy people by thy power and rules over them in love, be gracious enough to bless thy servants, our freeholders in this county of Passaic, that thy people may dwell in peace and safety through our Lord. Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence to remember all the men and women who died while serving in the United States Armed Forces and as first responders throughout the I have a motion to approve the minutes of September 24th.
Move it. Freeholders, Opter,
yes.
Best,
yes.
Duffy,
yes.
James,
yes.
Lepore, Deputy Director Lazara,
yes.
Director Bartlett,
yes.
Lou, I'm correct, there are no proclamations?
No.
Okay. Very good. So that brings us to freeholder reports. I'll be brief, but there's three things I want to mention. First of all, thank you to our Superintendent of Elections, Shona Mack, and our County Clerk, Danielle Ireland Imhoff, for a very interesting 2 days on Thursday and Friday. We had all the various new voting technologies that are available for possible adoption here in Passaic County and statewide. Not just on display, but for people to come out and try out. We had touchscreen voting machines with paper ballot, the so-called VVPAT, voter verified paper audit trail. We had paper ballots that the voter actually fills out and votes and scans in an optical scan machine like your SAT test. And it was a really interesting opportunity to look at those technologies from, I think, three different companies. We're on the cusp of a very important decision to make in choosing Passaic County's next voting technologies, and I appreciate the fact that the superintendent has been consistently very open and public about the opportunity to hear from people, give them a chance to kick the tires, and to take a look at how we might go about voting over the next decade or so as we retire the Sequoia Advantage machines that everyone is currently so accustomed to. I want to thank everybody who's emailed me with their input on that, and welcome more input, always. I want to mention two other things of note. This past weekend was Fallen Firefighters Remembrance Weekend, and an opportunity for us to remember those bravest who, as they say, rush into the danger that we're all rushing away from. And I'm glad that there were a couple of places around our county that fallen firefighters were remembered with special ceremonies and programs. I also want to mention that yesterday was Go Black for Refugees Day in protest, if you will, of the current presidential administration's new policy of reducing to only 18,000 the number of refugees the United States will admit in the year 2020. Our nation's founding principles are literally to be a refuge for those around the world, whatever they may be struggling with, to come here. I know that we in Passaic County have gone out of our way to support our refugee community, to support in particular Syrian and other refugees who have arrived from war-torn regions in these last couple of years. What we've seen is that they are remarkable additions to our community. They are part of what strengthens the fabric and the culture of our nation, and they achieve extraordinary things, up to and including a refugee who served as the Secretary of State of the United States just about 20 years ago, Madeleine Albright. I join with organizations and people across the country in a critique of the administration's decision. Historically, the United States has admitted about 95,000 refugees every year. Honestly, that number is too low, and lowering it is really an appalling turning of our back on, I think, one of the things that our nation really stands for. So I wanted to add my voice to so many others around the country that are talking about refugees. And I want to thank our congressional delegation that supported a resolution in the House of Representatives last week, H.R. 444, and that I hope will also support the GRACE Act, which is a piece of legislation that would return the United States to that historic level of just 95,000 refugees admitted each year. So with that, I will conclude my remarks. Turn it over to Ken.
I just want to put out a reminder, October 12th, this Saturday, is our fourth annual Cause of the Park event over in Worthville and Gothenburg Park. I owe a lot of thanks to our planning department and our parks department for all the work that you've put into it to make it a great success. We are having over 75 vendors there. We'll be doing canine demonstrations with the sheriff's department, and there'll be at least 15 rescue groups, so if you have room in your home for another little furry friend, it's a great place to come and find it. We encourage you to come. Also, and this has to do with the voting machines, pre-order. On October 25th, we're having our nonprofit summit up in at the Public Safety Academy in Wayne. And we're bringing the voting machines up there that day and invite the public in to try out the machines as you did here last week. And so if you haven't had a chance to see the machines and you have time to run up to the Public Safety Academy, we welcome you to come and partake. We have a great program going on, and I think it's something that you'll find very interesting. And we do love to get your feedback on these type of events. So those are the two events that I just wanted to bring to your attention.
Thank you very much. Bill Rocker?
I don't have too much more to add. I want to thank you for your remarks, Director, in regards to refugees. And I also want to thank Governor Murphy, who reopened the refugee office in New Jersey, reversing a decision that was very coldly made by former Governor Christie. And I think, unfortunately, we're handcuffed by what the federal government allows us to do here in New Jersey. But what is able to be done, the state is now doing to support refugee population. And for people who don't realize, refugees get very little to nothing when they come here. So if you can imagine being not planning to move halfway across the world with, you know, basically with maybe even what you can carry, and dealing with all that, ending up in a strange place where you may not even know the language or have any opportunities, and then having very little to no money in your pocket, you have very little guarantee for you. And so when people talk about the cost of these refugees, they're not really being honest in the actual cost of it. And yet still, we know that most of these refugees become very productive members of society and build families here who continue to help build this country. So I thank you for your words and for the governor's action.
Thank you.
Mr. Hoskins.
Bill
Duffy. We have a couple of things on the planning board that we will review and vote for. One, in particular, we have the development on Hamburg Turnpike Lane. We're looking for the traffic light, and I just want to make mention that the county does not put traffic lights on. I get a number of requests in town, especially West Milford, for traffic lights. But we're going to put this one, we're not putting in, the developer is, and Wayne will maintain it and keep it running where we have no obligation to it. So, other than that, I want to thank Saad Friedholder after. We're hosting the governor at your house. Quite nice. Appreciate it. And Sandy, I give you kudos for what's going on this Saturday. It's going to be a busy day for everyone, but you do a great job on that. Really do. My hats are off to you.
And thank you, Carol Duffy, for hosting a certain portion of our county population every day for 7 days a week.
You mean a first in the river 7 days a week? That would be a first in river in Patterson. Nice, sir.
Perfect. Thank you, sir.
Go to Dan.
I think all of us should encourage Sandy to adopt a couple more dogs.
Yeah.
We had two grandsons, so I
think. And two cats.
And two cats. So I think you've done enough with Wolf and other jobs. So we have one more or two more dogs. The first 15 resolutions came out of administration and finance. I hope you had a chance to review them. But we appreciate your support on them today. And yesterday, the class of 94 started at our police academy. Again, in many of the towns in northern New Jersey, not just Passaic County towns. For those of you, Tony and I attended the last graduation, which happened to be on the meeting night, and we were able to go and be involved. Hanging out without us. And it's good to see. There's a lot of young people now who are in our academy, a lot of the people in a lot of the police forces have reached retirement age, so it's going to be quite a turnover. We tend to have these big classes, so I was up there today, all looking good. It's good recruits.
Thank you very much. Good little report.
Director, we have 9 resolutions on the agenda for the great overview of the room and support.
If I may, Director, and I apologize, but since our last meeting, we did have a county employee after a long struggle with cancer pass away. Mark Julian, who worked in Buildings and Grounds, passed away about a week and a half ago. So I meant to tell you before the moment of silence, but I would just ask that you keep his family in your thoughts and prayers.
And we will. And before we move on, congratulations to Sheriff's Officers Jasmine Curry and Eric Blessing and their parents on their wedding this past weekend. With no communications, that brings us to the public portion of this evening's meeting. Can I have a motion to open? James and Austin.
Freehold is Octer.
Yes.
Bess.
Yes.
Duffy.
Yes.
James.
Yes.
Lepore.
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare.
Yes.
Director Bartlett.
Yes. So this is the part where the public can come to the podium, state your name and address, sign in. You have 3 minutes, and note that whatever you have to say will become part of the public record.
Seeing no one.
Good evening. Lucas Lott, and Montrose in Place, West Milford. I'm here tonight to continue a public discussion on the Roundup glyphosate spraying. You know, fellow members of the nation, West Milford, single West Milford, were here at the last meeting, and I'm hopeful for progress.
Thank you. I'm hopeful for progress as the discussion sounded positive. It is worth noting that the governing board of West Milford has unanimously supported an end to the spraying over the course of the last few years of this known carcinogen. In an effort to respect everyone's time, we will try to keep this brief. I understand the argument for this policy is an attempt at cost savings for county taxpayers, which I'm sure we all appreciate. However, that argument is invalid for several reasons. One, the weeds growing are not obstructing line of sight. They are in no way a safety issue. Two, the dead and dying plants are a complete eyesore as you drive around our otherwise beautiful reservoir, Jewel of the Highlands. Three, these plants help to filter out toxins from the soil and groundwater. I'd like to know that I did study environmental science at Ramapo College, and this is what's referred to as an ecosystem service. One that is especially needed along roadsides as toxic runoff, rich with oil and other vehicle pollutants, wash into our waterways and drinking water. The dead plant matter may also be great tinder for wildfires from a discarded cigarette, for example. The mowing or weed whacking may be more expensive, but the point I'd really like to drive home is that both are unnecessary. I'm really befuddled and honestly disappointed that this continues after 3 years of pleading when so many amazing alternatives, like discussed last week, exist. So few government entities employ the use of this product in such a way, and a majority of residents strongly oppose the spraying, and virtually no one is in favor of this. I welcome all of your thoughts and thank you for your time and service.
Seeing no one at the podium, I move to close the public hearing.
Second.
Freeholders, Apter?
Yes.
Bass?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Before?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes.
To the gentleman, I'm sorry, because of the microphone, I didn't get your name. But thank you very much for Lucas. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for coming. We did hear from a bunch of your neighbors last time around, and unfortunately, because of when you got here, we were going to hear from some of our staff, Paul Fenn, our environmental health staffer, Charlene Gungill, and Kenneth Simpson from Rhodes. Because no one was here from West Milford, we punted that to our next meeting. I apologize for that, but if you're not able to join us 2 weeks from now, by all means, Charlene and Paul, would you raise your hands? Okay, so there's Dr. Charlene Gungill, our health director. If you're not able to come next week, feel free to grab her at the end of the meeting with any questions that you might have. But thank you very much, Lucas, for being here. That brings us to our consent agenda. Can I have a motion to...
Freeholders, Apter?
Yes.
Best?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Lepore?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes. I have a motion to adopt the consent agenda K1 through K67.
Is that motion?
Freeholders, Apter?
Yes.
Best?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Lepore?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes. That brings us to new business. Can I have a motion on the personnel?
Oh.
Second.
Freeholders, Apter?
Yes.
Best?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Lepore?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes. Can I have a motion on the bill?
Second.
Freeholders, Apter?
Yes.
Best?
Yes.
Duffy?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Lepore?
Yes.
Deputy Director Lazare?
Yes.
Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Any thoughts? Through your director, first of all, I'd like to invite everyone downstairs for a little bit of Italian fare. provided by Congressman of Italy and Woodland Park, which was put together a good spread. And I also would like to wish my colleague on my right, his daughter is getting married this weekend.
Yes.
And
right?
not my daughter. Very good. And I hope you're here today for your daughter Erin and
Sean.
Sean.
Mario.
Who can hit a mean dog.
We need another one.
Thank you.
All right, can I have a motion to adjourn?
Three of those, Oster,
yes.
Best,
yes.
Duffy, James, Four,
yes.
Director Bartlett.
Yeah, thank you
all
very much. I'm really
good.
Hey folks, it's John Bartlett, your Passaic County freeholder and election lawyer. It's early September 2019, and I've been getting some questions about the vote-by-mail law that the legislature came back into special session last month to pass and Governor Murphy signed. So I wanted to explain it. You'll remember that after the 2016 presidential election, New Jersey adopted a new law where anyone who had voted by mail in the 2016 presidential automatically got a vote-by-mail ballot in 2018. That law was specific to the 2016 presidential ballot, and what they did last month is they went back and added a new provision so that if you asked for a VBM, a vote-by-mail ballot, in 2017 for the gubernatorial or in 2018 for the federal midterm election, you'll also go on that list of people who automatically get a vote-by-mail ballot from here on out unless you opt out of that vote-by-mail ballot. So what that means is if you're a new voter, you requested a VBM for the first time in 2017 or 2018, you will automatically get one in 2019 unless you contact your county clerk and opt out. That's good. It's going to make it easier for you to vote in this year's state midterm election where your turnout really, really matters. And if you have any questions about what it means to be on the vote by mail list, and specifically the fact that if you do get a vote by mail ballot, you will not be able to vote in the machine on election day, check out the other vote by mail explainer videos on my YouTube channel. I'll post a link in the comments below. And if you have any questions, reach me via email or via my website at johnbartlett.com. Thank you.
go out to sea again. Sunshine fills my hair, and dreams hang in the air. Girls in the sky and in my blue eyes, I know it feels unfair. There's magic everywhere. Look at me standing.